You're traveling through another dimension. A dimension not only of sight and sound, but of mind. A journey into a wondrous land whose boundaries are that of imagination. That's the signpost up ahead. Your next stop, the Twilight Zone.
E equals MC squared, the words of Albert Einstein. And from this wellspring, science built the atomic age. But it took 40 years and all the genius of man. In 1905, Einstein produces his startling equation and gives new meaning to Madame Curie's discovery of radium. For New Zealand's Ernest Rutherford, radium unlocks the heart of the atom. Rutherford's protege, James Chadwick, explores the atom and finds the neutron. Madame Curie's daughter, Irene Juliette Curie, experiments with the neutron. And her success leads Italy's Enrico Fermi to the brink of the greatest discovery. Without realizing it, Fermi has split the atom, violating a commonly held law of physics that an atom of matter cannot be created or destroyed. Fermi has released the enormous energy foreseen in Einstein's equation, E equals mc squared. One of Fermi's aides will later say, "We simply weren't prepared to see it."
Shadows of the posts on Yorozoyo Bridge indicate the direction of the explosion. 0.6 miles from zero point, the bridge floor is etched except where shielded by the railing. Outlined in the surface of the bridge is the shadow of a pedestrian which tells its own meaningful story. The commercial museum was also within 0.2 miles of zero point, and the garden wall facing the blast was bent inward by the push of the explosion. Looking east, an area of complete devastation is all that can be seen.
Bishop Polish still looks wonderful. There's not a sign of a chip anywhere. Now, girls, it's obvious that when Hazel Bishop's new polish withstands a test like that, it'll stay on your nails beautifully days longer than any other. So treat yourself to a professional Hazel Bishop manicure at your beauty shop, or get an economical bottle of Hazel Bishop's new longer-lasting nail polish wherever you buy your Hazel Bishop lipstick.
Very much, Bob Warren. I've been briefing Reverend Tanimoto on the show here. He's a little surprised. Now, Reverend Tanimoto, are you ready to turn the pages in this book and share with us your experiences? All right, then. August 6, 1945. Hiroshima, Japan. This is your life, Kiyoshi Tanimoto. The morning is perfectly clear, and as the warm summer sun rises above the mountains which run around three sides of the city, it awakens a sprawling community of 245,000 people. The time is 6 a.m. Now, what were you doing at 6 a.m., Reverend Tanimoto?
Well, I woke up and I was trying to evacuate some belongings of my church into a crane.
I see.
Yes.
To another friend's house?
Yes.
Were you expecting a bomb attack?
Yes, we thought something special would be given to us. Up until that time, we had no bombing at all, even though other cities already bombed.
Yes, so at 6 in the morning, you're lending a helping hand to a member of your parish, when suddenly blast of the air raid siren goes off. Did you run for cover? Not when the siren blew, did you? You were used to that. Every morning it went off.
Yes.
As I understand, there were U.S. Army reconnaissance planes flying overhead most of the time. So this was taken for granted, this air raid siren.
Yes.
This might happen even today in any typical American community. The sound of an air raid siren, even at 6 in the morning, is not taken too seriously.
He knew the world would not be the same. Few people laughed. Few people cried. Most people were silent. I remembered the line from the Hindu scripture, the Bhagavad Gita. Vishnu is trying to persuade prince that he should do his duty, and to impress him takes on his multi-armed form and says, "Now I am become death, the destroyer of worlds." I suppose we all thought that one way or another.
And looking down from thousands of feet over Hiroshima, all I could think of was, my God, what have we done?
The voice again of a man whose second of eternity was woven up with yours, Reverend Tanimoto. Now, you've never met him, have never seen him, but he's here tonight to clasp your hand in friendship. Captain Robert Lewis, United States Air Force, who along with Paul Tibbets piloted the plane from which the first atomic power was dropped over Hiroshima. And would you tell us, sir, of your experience on August 6, 1945?
Well, Mr. Edwards, we left Tinian in the Mariana Islands at about 2:45 in the morning on August the 6th, 1945. Our destination was Japan. We had three targets. One was Hiroshima, one was Nagasaki, one was Kokura. About an hour before we hit the coastline of Japan, we were notified that Hiroshima was clear. Therefore, Hiroshima became our target. Just before 8:15 a.m., Tokyo time, Tom Ferebee, a very able bombardier, carefully aimed at his target, which was the 2nd Imperial Japanese Army headquarters. 8:15, promptly, the bomb was dropped. We turned fast to get out of the way of the deadly radiation and bomb effects. First was the big flash that you got, and then the 2 concussion waves hit the ship. Shortly after, we turned back to see what had happened. And there in front of our eyes, the city of Hiroshima disappeared.
Now, you entered something in your log at that time.
As I said before, Mr. Edwards, I wrote down later, my God, what have we done?
The conventional bombs of World War II were called blockbusters. Filled with 20 tons of TNT, they could destroy a city block. All the bombs dropped on all the cities of World War II amounted to some 2 million tons of TNT, 2 megatons. Coventry and Rotterdam, Dresden and Tokyo, all the death that rained from the skies between 1939 and 1945. 100,000 blockbusters, 2 megatons. Today, 2 megatons is the equivalent of a single thermonuclear bomb, one bomb with the destructive force of the Second World War. But there are tens of thousands of nuclear weapons. The missile and bomber forces in the Soviet Union and the United States have warheads aimed at over 15,000 designated targets. No place on the planet is safe. The energy contained in these weapons, genies of death patiently awaiting the rubbing of the lamps, totals far more than 10,000 megatons, but with the destruction concentrated efficiently, not over 6 years, but over a few hours. A blockbuster for every family on the planet. A World War II every second for the length of a lazy afternoon.
I think the only hope for our future safety must lie in a collaboration based on confidence and good faith with the other peoples of the world.
And was the most, I'll never experience anything like it again, I know that.
It was completely daylight at midnight, brighter than the brightest day you ever saw.
I cannot begin to describe the light that came into my eye. I was totally blinded. When I came out of the blindness, I saw my hands, and by this time I actually saw the blood vessels and my bones in my arm, because as I came across like this, it actually was totally x-ray.
You could literally just see every bone in there, everything. Even the guy's bones and back that was in front of you.
That's how bright the light was, to go from through the back of your head, through your eyes, and into your fingers, you're seeing your bones and your hands.
How did it come through all that to get to your bones? That you could visually see them, like an x-ray.
The light faded, and it's like streaks of lightning from the ground to the sky, about every 2 feet around you. And then that faded, and it was like giant bar balls in front of your eyes.
When the wave hit me, it knocked me over. I actually flipped over. All of us fell down on the ground.
The blast caught me in the face, broke my glasses, knocked me on my butt, put a whole bunch of shrapnel in my face. It's mostly like little glass beads that were melted glass beads in my neck. And
it felt just like it would take red hot iron, like iron with an iron on an ironing board, and put it to your neck.
There was extreme heat. There was people screaming and running. There was panic. There was panic and people screaming because of the heat.
Everybody started yelling, and some people calling out for their mothers. Some of the trenches collapsed.
It's like I had lost it. And I don't know why, because I'm losing it right now.
The whole clump of ground, 10 yards this way, 15 yards this way, 10 yards back over here.
A few guys were having a little trouble. They were throwing up, and that's a normal thing, I guess.
We had to dig two guys out. And we're standing there watching the mushroom cloud form, and you could see it with the naked eyes as it sucked all the sand up.
Beautiful purples and lavenders popping and flipping and just doing.
And it was boiling, and just orange and reds and black and gray and whatever, and it just kept boiling. Rolling like this, and the higher it got, the more it flowed outward.
As it closed in, it was a huge red ring all the way around, as far as you could see from the horizon And as it closed up, like an aperture on a camera, on one side of the red ring was daylight, on the other side was night.
Woods, I think he defecated in his pants and all kinds of weird stuff.
Grown men in tears, and I saw officers saying the word, "Oh my God, what are we doing?"
The unforgettable sound of the roar, it roared, roared, and roared, and roared, and men yelling, and confused, and if it was done for science and the availability to the rest of the human race to know that that we don't need it, it's way too devastating. If you could just see the colors, if you could just hear it, not on the television or in the movie, but the actual thing, I think you would agree with me, whoever is listening to this.
осында күнімізде омна жақта отырғанда осы бұлай атылғанда тура кенімділәр. Қып-қызыл боп. Біз қаншама, мен жолдасында қаншама көрдік. Қаншама осы бадығының әсері. Әйтпесе кетейінде күні осы жоқ бадығының әсері.
Сарзаныңыз қалаға барғанда екі жылдан қайтыс болды.
А вот это и есть монстр. Вот он есть монстр. То есть то, что вообще-то несуразно, и не соответствует вообще принятым нормам. Череп, голова, лицо. Это разве не монстр? Единственный глаз, да еще волк. Циклоп.
Конечно, монстр.
Вот такие врожденные пороки встречаются по всему миру, мы говорили, где-то примерно до 1.5-2%. У нас в Симпатинском регионе в связи с функционированием ядерного полигона этих исследований атомной водородной бомбы возможность появления вот таких вот случаев гораздо выше. Это буквально в два раза чаще. И нужно предпринимать меры сейчас. И что без последствий не пройдет. И от того, что мы сейчас построим синовую голову в песок горою, проблема-то не ушла, она осталась. Я поэтому говорю, надо вот посмотреть на эту банку и представьте, что это ваш, у вашего единственного сына или дочери, желанного ребенка, вашему правнучке. Хотите? Пожалуйста. Что мне вас убеждать? Это ваше желание, оно свято. А я не хочу. И моя задача не допустить.
Stunning place, but its beauty hides a dark, dirty secret. This is a place whose atomic past is seared into its present. The people of Eniwetok were forced into exile by the atomic fallout. Allowed to return after three decades, a new generation is learning about the traditions and customs of this place. They have also been taught about America's toxic legacy and how it lies under a giant dome.
They understand. Somehow they understand that we have a poison in our island. That is what they call poison. They know that there's a doom because they have been there.
So the dome, you call it the tomb.
We call it the tomb.
6:45 a.m. on March 1st, 1954, the earth rumbled and shook,
a massive crater was formed in the Pacific Ocean as the largest hydrogen bomb to ever go off made its fateful detonation. An orange and yellow explosion that could be described as glorious shot up a cloud of radioactive debris that stretched 4.5 miles wide and 130,000 feet high into the sky above Bikini Atoll, a tiny island that's part of the Marshall Islands. It left a crater in the ocean floor with a diameter of 6,510 feet and a depth of 250 feet. Just to give you an idea of its magnitude, that's more than 18 football fields wide and almost an entire one deep. This lethal debris was still falling about 5 hours later on Rongelap, an atoll 97 miles away, where it came down like ashy snow, so naturally, kids played in it and even went so far as to eat it. This is the story of Castle Bravo, the thermal nuclear accident that ended up being 1,000 times more powerful than Hiroshima. It was a whopping 2.5 times more intense than they had anticipated and can be attributed to some seriously complicated scientific miscalculations. Essentially, what happened was that scientists at the time didn't realize that the solid source of fusion fuel we mentioned earlier, a lithium deuteride, would react the way it did in this extreme situation. And as it turns out, a tiny scientific mistake can have almost unfathomable results. An area of 7,000 miles surrounding Bikini Atoll was contaminated, most notably the atolls of Rongelap and Uterik, and they felt the effects of radioactive poison almost immediately and for decades afterward.
A 7-month-old sunrise of gummy smiles. You are bald as an egg and bald as the Buddha. You are thighs that are thunder, shrieks that are lightning, so excited for bananas, hugs, and our morning walks along the lagoon. Dear Mata Felipeno, I want to tell you about that lagoon. That lazy, lounging lagoon, lounging against the sunrise. Men say that one day, that lagoon will devour you. They say it will gnaw at the shoreline, chew at the roots of your breadfruit trees, gulp down rows of seawalls, and crunch through your island's shattered bones.
Dear Mata Felipinum, don't cry. Mommy promises you no one will come and devour you. No one's drowning, baby. No one's moving. No one's losing their homeland. No one's going to become a climate change refugee.
In a place known for sober speeches and poker-faced diplomacy, Kathy Jetnell Kijana's pledge to her daughter to fight climate change moved many to tears.
I mean, when they all stood up, I kind of thought they were just being polite, but I just found out later that that doesn't happen all the time.
It was one of the most dramatic acts of the Cold War, and one that needs to be known to people all over the world.
So, Mr. Petrov, it's my great pleasure to present this award to you.
Уважаемые дамы и господа.
Dear ladies and gentlemen.
Мне очень приятно и радостно встретиться с вами в такой аудитории. Одно только меня смущает очень. Это то, что когда меня называют там, что я что-то совершил, что-то героическое. Трудность заключалась в том, что я не был на 100% уверен в правильности своего решения. У меня были большие-большие сомнения. Это было безумно трудное решение. Ну, как видите, мы все живы-здоровы, и мы с вами сидим здесь и улыбаемся друг другу. I am not a hero. I was just at the right place at the right time. At the right place at the right time. Ведь мир никогда не был так близок к катастрофе, как именно в этом 83-м году. Достаточно было одной малейшей искры, и мир бы просто взорвался на кусочки. Вот почему мы все должны помнить. Но те ядерные арсеналы, которые существуют, с той и с другой стороны, пока не существуют, так опасность ядерной войны исключать нельзя.
By U.S. estimates, Iran is 1 to 5 years away from having a nuclear weapons capability.
North Korea says it successfully carried out yet another underground nuclear test.
States and the Soviet Union have managed to booby-trap the planet with about 60,000 nuclear weapons, with a little help from Britain, France, China, and Israel. A tiny fraction of those weapons is enough to destroy the participating nations, certainly the global civilization, possibly, and the human species, just maybe. It is now time for the United States and the Soviet Union to demonstrate that they can undo this specter, that they can demonstrate their ability to work together on high technology for peaceful, hopeful purposes that carry us into a benign 21st century.
Hiroshima, Japan, 100,000 people died. Over time, even more powerful bombs were built, hydrogen bombs. This 1960s airplane carried 5 hydrogen bombs, red and white things there, and had the power of 500 Hiroshima bombs. And of course, the United States and Russia don't just use airplanes. They have intercontinental ballistic missiles with hydrogen bombs on them. And they have nuclear submarines with missiles. A single Trident missile submarine can carry 100 hydrogen bombs with the explosive power of 1,000 Hiroshima bombs. Knowing the power of the bombs and their targets, we can understand the destructiveness and loss of life that might occur if these were ever used. Let us imagine, for example, that the United States attacks Pyongyang, North Korea, the capital, with the smallest bomb carried on a Trident missile submarine. 500,000 people, about the population of Sacramento or Baltimore, would die. Nuclear weapons kill people in 4 different ways. In this orange circle, there's a shock wave so powerful that it knocks down concrete buildings and kills everyone within that zone. In the red circle, there's radiation that's released from the atomic bomb as it fissions. The radiation would kill 50 to 90% of the North Koreans over the next few weeks. In this green circle, the shockwave continues out with enough power to knock down residential buildings. And in this yellow circle, 6 miles in diameter, there's a blast of light so bright that if your skin was exposed, you'd get third-degree burns, which can be fatal. And flammable things like leaves, newspapers, and your clothes would burst into flames. And of course, if we attack North Korea, they're likely to attack us back. If they use the same size weapon that we used, and they've already tested one like this, they could kill 150,000 people in this 6-mile diameter circle in Denver. And these terrifying scenarios I'm talking about are just if each side uses one nuclear weapon. But Russia and the United States each have 4,000 strategic nuclear weapons. That's enough to attack each city with more than 100,000 people in each country with 10 atomic bombs.
The reason no government wants you to think about all this is because there is no serious humanitarian response possible to a nuclear explosion. Playing around with nuclear weapons in videos is fun. There's a visceral joy in blowing things up and a horrifying fascination with things like fireballs, shockwaves, and radiation. And while it does help put our destructive power in perspective, it's not the best way of understanding the real impact of a nuclear explosion. This isn't about city stacks of TNT or about how bright an explosion is. Nuclear weapons are about you. So we've partnered with the Red Cross and Red Crescent movement to explore what would really happen if a nuclear weapon were detonated in a major city today. Not nuclear war, just one explosion. We begin our story in the middle of downtown in a major city. People are going to work, studying for exams, are lost in their thoughts and daily lives.
All right. Wow, that's very loud. Sorry about the sound issue there. Nothing like following lunch with a little video about nuclear Armageddon. This next expert briefing, we're gonna expound on some of the things that were talked about in the video, including some of the things that perhaps you didn't hear. And we're going to expound a bit on what you heard earlier this morning from Setsuko Thurlow and Leona Morgan about risks and consequences of nuclear weapons.
After the Cold War ended and we got, for example, the INF Treaty in 1987, there were 50,000 nuclear weapons at that time. Then the Cold War ended and these things were actually connected. And everybody seemed to think, oh, well, nuclear problem has gone away because they're reducing and they're reducing. And, you know, there's 13,000 nuclear weapons still there. So actually, yeah, they reduced, but there's 9 nuclear armed states now as well. So the risks are ninefold times, and it's not the weapons or the size, it's how they're thought about. So let me tell you about some of the risks that we still face. Nuclear weapons have been dropped from aeroplanes by mistake in Spain, in Greenland, but many of you didn't know about that. They travel in a number of countries like, you know, Russia and others on trains, and that causes its own problem in the UK, and I bet I'm not sure, the French ones can tell us exactly how the warheads travel to the deploy, you know, from the warhead research manufacturing factories to the deployment on the French missiles and submarines. But in the UK, they travel by road. And now we are hearing at last again the leaders in some of the nuclear armed states, right, saying the risks and the threats from nuclear weapons are getting closer. Now that's a really bad thing, but at least they are now beginning to acknowledge just how many ways things can go wrong and nuclear weapons can end up being exploded intentionally but through use or by accident. And if one is exploded, the fear of those situations can lead to a nuclear so-called exchange, which of course is nuclear war.
When you attend a funeral, it is sad to think that sooner or later those you love will do the same for you. And you may have thought it tragic, not to mention other adjectives, to think of all the weeping they will do. But don't you worry, no more ashes, no more sackcloth, and an armband made of black cloth will someday nevermore adorn a sleeve. For if the bomb that drops on you gets your friends and neighbors too, there'll be nobody left behind to grieve, and we will all go together when we go. What a comforting fact that is to know. Universal bereavement, an inspiring achievement. Yes, we all will go together when we go. We will all bake together when we bake. There'll be nobody present at the wake. With complete participation in that grand incineration, nearly 3 billion hunks of well-done steak. We will all fry together when we fry. We'll be French fried potatoes by and by. There will be no more misery when the world is our rotisserie. Yes, we all will fry together when we fry. We will all char together when we char. And let there be no moaning of the bar. Just sing out a te deum when you see that ICBM, and the party will be come as you are. We will all burn together when we burn. There'll be no need to stand and wait your turn. When it's time for the fallout and St. Peter calls us all out, we'll just drop our agendas and adjourn. And we will all go together when we go. Every Hottentot and every Eskimo. When the air becomes Uranus, we will all go simultaneous. Yes, we all will go together when we all go together. Yes, we all will go together when we go.
The car is on fire, and there's no driver at the wheel. And the sewers are all muddied with 1,000 lonely suicides. And a dark wind blows. The government is corrupt. And we're on so many drugs with the radio on and the curtains drawn. We're trapped in the belly of this horrible machine. And the machine is bleeding to death. The sun has fallen down. And the billboards are all leering. And the flags are all dead. At the top of their poles. It went like this. The buildings toppled in on themselves. Mothers clutching babies picked through the rubble and pulled out their hair. The skyline was beautiful on fire. Metal stretching upwards. Everything washed in a thin orange haze. I said, kiss me, you're beautiful. These are truly the last days. You grabbed my hand and we fell into it like a daydream or a fever.
Technically and intellectually, we are living in an atomic age. Emotionally, we are still living in the Stone Age. The Aztecs, on their feast days, would sacrifice 20,000 men to their gods in the belief that this would keep the universe on its proper course. We feel superior to them.
Mm-hmm. I was a launch officer for Minuteman missiles. And spent 3 years in Montana in a hole in an underground launch control center. I was one of the guys responsible for getting these missiles off the ground in 1 minute. We didn't call them Minuteman missiles for nothing. When I was serving in the Air Force as a launch officer, there was a device in the launch control center into which 12 digits had to be dialed in order to unlock the missiles for firing. This had been installed under Robert McNamara over the objections of the Strategic Air Command. Since they couldn't prevent the panel from being installed, the Strategic Air Command in Omaha had set these codes to zero. And we all knew it. That was the secret unlock code for firing our missiles. 12 zeros. In fact, in our launch checklist, we had to ensure that the unlock code was set to all zeros before we completed the launch sequence. This changed in 1977 when they started using actual codes. But until then, I and one other crew member could have actually formatted a launch order, a completely valid launch order, and transmitted it to the entire American strategic arsenal.
It looks like we're in a shooting war.
The hell. All the Russians involved, sir.
Hendrick, that's all I've been told.
I just came in on the red phone. My orders are for this base to be sealed tight, and that's what I mean to do, seal it tight. Now, I want you to transmit Plan R, R for Robert, to the wing.
Plan R for Robert.
Is it that bad, sir?
It looks like it's pretty hairy.
Yes, sir.
I remember watching Dr. Strangelove and thinking they had it all wrong. You don't need to be a general. We were only lieutenants, but we could have started World War III just as easily as General Jack Ripper. We could have triggered implementation of the U.S. nuclear war plan involving thousands and thousands of nuclear weapons fired at the Soviet Union in China.
America, how well are we taking care of these things?
America, fuck yeah, coming again to save the motherfucking day, yeah. America, fuck yeah,
freedom is the only way, yeah.
Terrorists, your game is through, 'cause now you have.
Take this enormous outer door designed to protect the corridor leading to the capsule. They can't close it because of a broken part, so it's propped open with a crowbar and marked with a danger tag. The equipment is ancient. This, for example, is one of the computers that would receive a launch order from the president. It uses floppy disks, the really old, big ones.
A conflict in North Korea, John, would be probably the worst kind of fighting in most people's lifetimes. It would be a catastrophic war if this turns into combat, if we're not able to resolve this situation through diplomatic means.
Picture this, four Air Force officers who hold the launch keys to nuclear missiles, leaving open the blast door that's supposed to prevent terrorists from entering the capsule. And who discovered this? In one case, it was a maintenance team. In another case, it was discovered by someone delivering food.
Someone dropped a socket in the silo, and the socket fell about 70 feet, pierced the missile, caused a fuel leak, and then there was a huge explosion.
Six nuclear-tipped cruise missiles were loaded onto a B-52 by mistake, flown across the country, and left unguarded on the tarmac. No one noticed for 36 hours.
Since nuclear weapons were first deployed in the 1950s, there have been many close calls. What's more horrifying is that most of these have been inadvertent, due to malfunction, human error, or misunderstanding. In 1962, the Soviet Union placed nuclear-armed missiles in Cuba, targeting the United States in retaliation for United States missiles placed in Turkey. US President Kennedy threatened the Soviets with nuclear attack because he didn't know that those Soviet missiles were nuclear armed and that there were Soviet operators in Cuba ready to use them. I remember, aged 18, my anxiety when the whole world held its breath. Catastrophic nuclear war was averted by luck and a secret agreement to withdraw missiles from Turkey and Cuba. Less than 30 years later, Iraq invaded Kuwait in 1990. Speaking to 20,000 anti-war protesters in London, I warned that if Saddam Hussein felt personally threatened, he could attack Israel with conventionally armed Scud missiles and become the Arabs' champion. If one Scud attack caused excessive casualties, Israel's leader would come under massive pressure to respond with a nuclear strike on Baghdad. A week after I spoke, Israelis learned that their nuclear deterrent had failed. 39 Scud attacks from Iraq caused miraculously few casualties. The Americans rushed more anti-Scud missile defenses there and congratulated Israel on its restraint. Fast forward 5 years. In 1995, a Norwegian research rocket was misidentified by Russian radar as an incoming United States nuclear strike. The Russian leader activated his special briefcase authorizing nuclear-armed submarines to prepare for launch. Catastrophe was avoided by a few minutes. Which brings me to the ongoing crisis in Northeast Asia, custom built to showcase nuclear deterrence. Mad, bad North Korean leader Kim Jong-un is portrayed as the new Hitler of the nuclear weapons. So Donald Trump declares that if the United States is threatened, either itself or its allies, they will have no choice but to totally destroy North Korea. That makes Trump little better than Kim. Both have bought into the bogus mantra that only nuclear deterrence can guarantee their country's security.
The words even to express the moment we now are in. What you're hearing this morning is really the voice of prophets of doom, speaking of danger and destruction is never very easy. If you speak the truth, people will not want to listen because it's too awful and it makes you sound like a crackpot. So let me speak from the position of someone who spent most of his life in politics. Even if there's one in 100 chances that these men and women before you are correct, then we are truly in a dangerous moment. But you would never know that from the president, from the Republican leadership, or even from the Democratic leadership. Talking about what we're talking about today is profoundly deviant to our contemporary culture. We're not supposed to be here. We're not supposed to utter the truth about the power of mankind to destroy itself. What is being said this morning is not being heard. It's being ignored, it's being denied, and it's being belittled. We are in a predicament because the power that mankind has generated is completely at variance with the seriousness with which it's understood, or the extent by which people understand it. So that's why the clock has been moved forward 100 seconds before doomsday. Tell me, how else can we tell people where we're at? How else can we wake up the Democrats, the Republicans, the independents, the millionaires, the billionaires, the media owners, who carry on their life as though they're on the Titanic, about ready to hit an iceberg, and they're not worried? Very few people are worried. I have never in my entire life heard a group of scientists and serious statespeople say what they've just said. This is the moment, if there ever was, to wake up. It's now, and those who have to wake up are you. And I hope that not one person here feels any cynicism, complacency, or feeling that we're not in this predicament. We're in it, it's dire, but we're not there yet. We can still pull back from the brink. But we have to do what we're not doing. Whatever we've done to date, it is totally inadequate on nuclear, on climate, and on the other dangerous technologies. We have to find a way to do more. We have to change the design of how we're behaving. When I say we, I mean people in this room. I mean Congress. I mean the campaign contributors. I've spent my life seeking the favor of these powerful people. I can tell you, most of them are totally ignorant, blind, and deaf to our predicament. So the task is wake up. Wake up, America. Wake up, the world. It is 100 minutes before doomsday.
100 seconds before doomsday.
Seconds.
What? Seconds. It's 100 seconds to do
seconds.
This.
Well, there it just shows you. We don't even know what the hell we're talking about. There's exhibit A of why we got a problem.
The most likely way for a nuclear war to start isn't political, it's accidental. For example, the time faulty computer chips in US alarm systems erroneously signaled incoming Soviet missiles and the US started to prepare for full-blown retaliation. Or that time when Russian satellites mistook an unusual glint of sunlight off of clouds for incoming American missiles and an officer averted retaliation just by ignoring the alarm on gut instinct. Or the time after the Cold War ended when Russian radar systems thought a Norwegian scientific rocket was an American nuclear missile and almost launched their missiles in retaliation. You know, these close calls keep happening, and sooner or later our luck is going to run out and an entire nuclear arsenal is going to be launched accidentally. Given the risks of accidental nuclear war and nuclear winter, it's stupid, dangerous, and irresponsible for any country on Earth to have more nuclear weapons than it needs for deterrence. If we continue hoarding excessive nuclear arsenals, winter is coming.
Today, Russia and the US have 90% of the world's remaining nukes, many of them old and prone to error and false alarm. And they're in the hands of leaders who Perry sees as having cavalier attitudes about their potential.
Are there things you see with President Trump that concern you?
Yes. I think, unlike President Obama, he doesn't have a clear understanding of what the nuclear issues are and what the nuclear dangers are. Secondly, I think he's demonstrated an impulsive temperament. The first of them is solvable. He can learn more if he cares to do it. The temperament issue, I'm afraid, is just there.
The fourth generation is a hypothetical hydrogen bomb that does not need a fission primary explosive to ignite the fusion of deuterium and tritium. The main reason weapon developers want to create such a device is that it would require no fissile material and would, therefore, be much easier to develop in secret than the standard thermonuclear weapons. Following the Ivy Mike test, the U.S. spent 40 years and millions of dollars trying to produce a pure fusion weapon. Despite this, no significant advances were made. Isomers of the elements hafnium and tantalum can be induced to create incredibly strong gamma radiation. Emission of gamma from hafnium or tantalum isomers may just have enough energy to trigger a thermonuclear reaction without fission material, such as deuterium or tritium. But as of right now, it is still nothing but one of the many theories as how to do it.
There really are two types of missiles emerging: hypersonic cruise missiles
and hypersonic glide vehicles, hypersonic cruise missiles are powered all the way to their targets using an advanced propulsion system called a scramjet. These are very, very fast. You may have 6 minutes from the time it's launched until the time it strikes. So hypersonic glide vehicles are just that. They're a very fast glider.
The way it's launched is they put it on top of a rocket, it re-enters, then it flies on top of the atmosphere. It's like a plane with no engine on it. And it uses aerodynamic forces to maintain stability, to fly along, and to maneuver.
Because it's maneuverable, it can keep its target a secret up until the last few seconds of its flight.
The current types of missile defenses are not adequate to defend against hypersonic missiles.
Our whole defensive system is based on the assumption that you're going to intercept a ballistic object.
A ballistic missile is like a fly ball in baseball. The outfielder knows exactly where to catch it because its path is determined by momentum and gravity.
It's a different scenario. The combination of the maneuverability and the speed makes hypersonic missiles unpredictable and extremely difficult to defend against.
The faster you go, the more kinetic energy you have. In some cases, you may not need to put any explosives on it. The kinetic energy of the vehicle itself is sufficient to be able to cause quite a bit of destruction.
You can make a model of a nuclear reactor using these materials which you have at home. Thorium is a radioactive element which is used in old gas lanterns to make them glow more brightly. To extract thorium for your own experiments, get as many lantern mantles as you can find. Blowtorch them into a powder. Mix the powder with some lithium from a battery. Then wrap it all up in foil. Now heat your chemicals in a tin can filled with cooking oil. This will give you pure radioactive thorium. If you have enough of it, you can fuel a nuclear reactor. In a reactor, thorium can change into uranium or plutonium, which is used in nuclear bombs. A neutron gun makes elements radioactive, so you'll want to build your own. You will need a lead block, some aluminum foil, and the radioactive americium from hundreds of smoke detectors. The americium will give off a stream of radioactive alpha rays. When alpha rays hit the aluminum in the foil, they produce subatomic particles called neutrons. Neutrons react with other elements and turn them radioactive. Your neutron gun is neutron fun and an excellent source of radiation. To extract the radium from your glow-in-the-dark clock, you have to take the hands off very carefully. Gently dip the hands in solvent to remove the paint. And there you have it. Real glowing radioactive radium. An excellent high-grade source for your reactor. It's time to bring together everything you've learned from your nuclear experiments. Place the americium from the smoke detectors and radium from the clocks on a piece of foil. This will be the radioactive core of your reactor. Make some cubes out of the thorium from the gas lanterns and ordinary charcoal, and wrap them in foil too. Arrange the cubes into a bigger cube. Drop the americium and radium core into the center of the cube and bind it all together in duct tape. Cobalt drill bits will act as your control rods. This is now a makeshift reactor. If the reactor is working, you can now make plutonium.
Oh. шампанского остальной борт корабля.
Со скоростью 5 метров в час лодка движется к воде. «Белгород» — первая подлодка-носитель оружия нового поколения, беспилотных подводных аппаратов «Посейдон», способных с высочайшей скоростью перемещаться на межконтинентальные расстояния.
Рассчитываю, что намеченные сроки строительства будут, безусловно, выдержаны. Это принципиально важно для выполнения масштабных планов укрепления флота, для надежной обороны морских рубежей России.
There's another system, an underwater system that the Russians are working on and that Putin has been bragging about. It's called the Poseidon. It is a nuclear powered, that's right, it's a torpedo with a nuclear reactor in it that can also carry nuclear warheads. It is very long range, up to about 6,000 miles. It can travel at depths of up to 3,000 feet. And it's very fast. Somewhere the estimates are between 55 and 100 knots, 55 to 100 miles an hour underwater. The idea for this weapon is to go after large ships like aircraft carriers or shore installations. And again, this is not a system for which we have adequate defenses right now. Very worrisome. This is in testing right now, not in the fleet, not far as far along as the Avant-Garde.
Давайте чуть подробнее на Посейдоне остановимся. Для чего создан этот подводный комплекс?
Посейдон необходим прежде всего для того, чтобы наносить удары по военно-морским базам, где, например, базируются атомные подводные лодки стратегического класса противника. Аппарат идет на глубине порядка 1 километра с огромной скоростью, и сегодня не существует никаких средств для обнаружения, тем более для перехвата подобного рода подводного аппарата. Он несет кобальтовый заряд огромной мощности и является абсолютным оружием, не имеющим сегодня аналогов. Очевидно, никто такие аналоги в течение ближайших 20-30 лет в мире создать не сможет. Это средство для сдерживания, для того, чтобы те, кто развертывает системы противоракетной обороны и испытывает иллюзии относительно того, что этими системами может девальвировать российский стратегический потенциал сдерживания, мы демонстрацией новой системы «Посейдон» говорим о том, что те многомиллиардные вложения в систему ПРО, которые были сделаны, они фактически обесцениваются тем, что средства для ответного удара возмездия в России имеется. И это очень серьезный сигнал, который будет отрезвлять тех политиков и военных, которые вынашивали какие-либо агрессивные замыслы в отношении нашей страны.
The first public report of the weapon system dates back to September 2015, and the details are genuinely insane. It's a weapon so powerful it seems like it should belong in a bad science fiction movie, and yet it's apparently quite real. Poseidon is an unmanned drone in the shape of a torpedo that can be loaded onto and launched by a submarine. A Poseidon drone could also remain dormant in a box on the ocean floor, just waiting for a signal to come back to life before carrying out its apocalyptic attack, like a Reaper from Mass Effect. Either way, once a Poseidon is armed and activated, it can have a range of 10,000 kilometers, and it slowly travels across the ocean ominously towards its target over a period of weeks or even months. The drone travels so slowly in order to avoid detection. But when it's nearby an enemy coastline, it rushes ahead at over 100 miles per hour to get close enough to detonate its nuclear bomb before it's detected. The bomb that the Poseidon drone carries is allegedly the most powerful nuclear device ever created, capable of unleashing a completely insane 200 megatons of explosive power, and all of it underwater. For reference as to why that's insane, the biggest bomb ever tested by humanity so far was the Tsar Bomba by the Soviet Union. That bomb destroyed every building in a 55-kilometer radius, caused third-degree burns 100 kilometers away, and shattered windows that were 900 kilometers away. It was detonated here in Novaya Zemlya, and shattered windows all the way over here in northern Norway and Finland. The shockwave from the explosion circled the entire Earth 3 times, and despite all of that awesome power, it was only 50 megatons. The Poseidon bomb has 4 times that amount of power.
unleashing that amount of raw power underwater is allegedly enough to generate a 500-meter-high tsunami wave in the direction of an enemy's coastline. That wave would be so high that it's almost impossible to fully appreciate. So here is what the Empire State Building would look like right next to it. The 2004 Indian Ocean tsunami that devastated Indonesia only reached a maximum height of only 30 meters, and is over 16 times shorter than the Poseidon tsunami. What's even worse, though, is the Poseidon nuclear bomb is apparently a cobalt bomb, specifically designed to unleash more radioactive fallout than a normal nuclear bomb. This not only makes the wave freakishly huge, but also intensely radioactively contaminated. So now imagine you're just chilling, hanging out on the coast, and you notice a 500-meter-high radioactive death tsunami bearing down on you. What would you do in that situation? The weapon is apparently specifically designed to circumvent the capable US and European missile defense systems. If nuclear missiles are heading towards your country, you can at least try and shoot some of them down before they make an impact and you have a chance. But what chance do you have at stopping a 500-meter-high mega tsunami? Once the bomb has gone off underwater, it's already pretty much too late. The tsunami is going to happen. This is a simulated flood projection that was developed by the University of Washington if only a 100-megaton bomb was detonated underwater off the coast of Long Island. But even a 100-megaton bomb would apparently flood the entirety of Long Island, all of New York City, and significant portions of Connecticut, New Jersey, and other areas. As mentioned previously, the Poseidon bomb has double that amount of power. A 500-meter-high tsunami would be taller than every single building in New York except for the One World Trade Center, and it would still be very close. Everything in the city would be destroyed, and the highly radioactive water would linger around and poison the ground and the drinking supply. It would be absolutely catastrophic, and the Russian Navy has allegedly already ordered 30 Poseidon-armed drones to enter into service, with half of them going to the Northern Fleet in the Arctic Ocean and the other half going to the Pacific Fleet based in Vladivostok. The Poseidon drones are a weapon only of last resort, with enough power to give their operators the equivalent power of an angry god from 1,000 years ago. They are to be used only as a last-ditch effort when all other hope for Russia during a war seems lost.
The bulletin is thus joining with tomorrow's leaders and today's to assert that the current environment is profoundly unstable and urgent action and immediate engagement is required by all. Today, the Bulletin of the Atomic Scientists moves the hands of the doomsday clock. It is 100 seconds to midnight.
Delegates from more than 40 countries are in Russia as concerns grow about the threat of nuclear war.
Tensions are running high between China and India. This week, soldiers from the two countries brawled along the border, leaving at least 20 dead.
North Korea now indicating it could resume nuclear weapons and long-range missile testing in the new year. State-run news reporting that Kim Jong-un told top party officials that the U.S. has not lifted sanctions and therefore Pyongyang, he says, is no longer committed to its own moratorium on nuclear weapons and long-range missile testing.
Russia and the U.S. have abandoned a treaty on limiting nuclear missiles. And a year after America pulled out of the 2015 Iran nuclear deal, Tehran is taking more steps to produce enriched uranium, which could be used for weapons.
Tensions on the Korean Peninsula hit a new low on Tuesday when Pyongyang blew up its joint liaison office with Seoul. Up until a year ago, the two had been making steps toward a more peaceful coexistence. There's little sign of any of that now.
Now, according to a U.S. media report that quotes a report released by the U.S. State Department, China might be secretly conducting nuclear tests with low explosive power. Now, this particular report has led to a lot of ripples, but it states that China might be, in fact, conducting nuclear tests without informing the world bodies about the same. This is a media report that cites, in fact, a report that's put out by the U.S. State Department.
This is the most serious confrontation since 2017, when Chinese troops, with construction vehicles and road-building equipment, began extending an existing road southward in Doklam, a territory which is claimed by China, India, and India's ally, Bhutan.
President Trump unveiled his 2021 budget request Monday, proposing massive cuts to Medicaid and food stamps while increasing spending on the military and his border wall. The $4.8 trillion budget would slash Environmental Protection Agency spending by more than a quarter, while allocating $18 billion for Trump's newly established Space Force. Trump is also requesting billions more for nuclear weapons, including a new submarine-launched nuclear warhead. Experts and Democratic lawmakers warn that increasing the nuclear stockpile will increase the likelihood of nuclear war and defy international agreements.
With all of our NATO partners, that we need to speak out more clearly about Russian noncompliance. You mentioned Georgia and Kaliningrad. Those are two good examples. We've also been denied access to military exercise overflights. There are some other issues that we cannot discuss in this session, which we should come and talk to you about. But I have a lot of concerns about the treaty as it stands now.
A major military parade is underway in Moscow to mark 75 years since the end of World War II. President Vladimir Putin addressed the crowd gathered for the parade in Red Square. Thousands of soldiers and several foreign delegations are attending the event. We're looking at some live pictures here. The Victory Day parade was originally scheduled for May 9th, but was postponed because of the coronavirus pandemic. The Kremlin has dismissed criticism, that it's irresponsible to go ahead with it now, saying infections in Moscow are declining.
The Federation of American Scientists revealed in late January the U.S. Navy had for the first time deployed a submarine armed with a low-yield Trident nuclear warhead. The USS Tennessee deployed from Kings Bay Submarine Base in Georgia in late 2019, armed with a warhead, which is estimated to have about a third of the explosive power of the atomic bomb the U.S. dropped in Hiroshima.
The Trump plan envisages Israel annexing 30% of the occupied West Bank, with a future Palestinian state given Israeli territory elsewhere. Israeli officials have leaked various options in the media. One is to begin with some or all of the major illegal settlement blocks: Ariel, Male Adumim, and the Etzion block near Bethlehem. The mayor of Efrat, within the Etzion block, argues for moving quickly and taking what's been put on the table by the U.S. administration. They're lobbying against annexation based on the Trump plan because it means agreeing in principle to a Palestinian state. For the Palestinian leadership, the precise nature of the first step doesn't matter. Any annexation is illegal and must be stopped.
What we hope is that Israel should not continue to be above international law. What we hope is that, really, Israel should feel the heat of international pressure.
I think that we see maybe the beginning of a little bit of a creation of an argument that Iran is developing weapons of mass destruction and that the United States is going to have to take action against that. And you've seen now from the president a number of very blunt statements that have said, we will not allow Iran to obtain a nuclear weapon.
President Rouhani has said that there will be further acts on behalf of Iran if the European Union does not change its policy.
Construction of Africa's largest dam nearly complete. Hard bargaining is coming to a head. That's nothing new between Egypt and Ethiopia, both of whom see the Nile's waters as an issue of national security. In Egypt's case, there's also a potential second front, spiking tension to the west in neighboring Libya.
Why do you think more people don't even realize how close we are, according to them, to nuclear catastrophe?
The whole situation is too frightening for us to even look at it. There's going to be an accident, and that some hothead in a submarine is going to go, oh my God, we're under attack, and press the button, and then we're all dead.
Well, there are calls on India to retaliate for the loss of life. Protesters burned the Chinese president in effigy. There are also calls for boycotting Chinese products.
Bharat shanti chahta.
India wants peace, the Prime Minister says, but if provoked, will provide an appropriate response.
Making its message clear and unequivocal, the destruction of the Joint Liaison Office has been widely broadcast by North Korean state-run media.
And in September, Pakistan's Prime Minister warned the UN of a potential nuclear war with India over the conflict in Kashmir.
Guard posts that had been removed to de-escalate tensions will now be restored, while military exercises on the northern side of the border will be resumed, bringing this unusually strong response from the south.
Such moves thwart the efforts and achievements made by the two Koreas to maintain peace, and the North will surely pay if these measures are put into action.
Last-ditch talks at an international non-proliferation conference in Beijing failed. The United States says that Russia has been lying about the capabilities of its newest cruise missiles. Russia says that isn't true, that it's the United States that has violated the INF Treaty, and that Washington has long wanted to start a new arms race.
Do you think coronavirus and the threat of that will have somehow made our leaders understand this nuclear threat you're talking about?
I don't think so. They'll just shovel it up more under the carpet. It's a great way of making money.
The Trump administration will reinterpret a Cold War-era arms control agreement in order to help American defense contractors sell military drones to more nations. Three defense industry executives and a U.S. official told Reuters about the policy change, which has not previously been reported. The change concerns the 33-year-old Missile Technology Control Regime, or MTCR, a pact created to curb arms proliferation, which counts 34 member nations. Washington has long seen the MTCR's restrictions on cruise missile sales as applicable to large weaponized drones.
So the Iranians are giving the Europeans 60 days to decide whether they're going to abide by the commandments of Trump, or are they going to protect their citizens, their businesses, their banks, and abide by their commitments.
Is there a concern that we could be seeing a new arms race?
Absolutely, and I think part of it is because you have now seen that we have some very immature people potentially in charge of these weapons.
Our nuclear is now up to snuff at a level that it's never been.
India, Pakistan, Israel, and North Korea aren't restricted by the pact.
Destabilizing deployment further increases the potential for miscalculation during a crisis.
And for those of us who live in Europe, we have to be extremely aware of the fact that INF was protecting us and not protecting the continental United States.
The International Campaign to Abolish Nuclear Weapons, ICAN, called the news an alarming development that heightens the risk of nuclear war.
This is BBC One. We're interrupting our program for a BBC News report.
Attention. Attention. The UK is currently under attack from nuclear weapons. You have approximately 4 minutes to find shelter. Communications have been severely disrupted. The number of casualties and the extent of the damage are not yet known. Stay tuned to this channel, stay calm, and stay indoors. This is not a test.
10 seconds. 5 seconds.
1 statement of fact. For civilization to survive, the human race has to remain civilized. One very small exercise in logic from the Twilight Zone.
Thank you.
sweet.